Hey guys, welcome to the Bunkai Breakdown. My name is Mr. T, and I want to talk to you today about the front stance. The front stance is going to be the single most foundational stance we're going to use again and again in Taekwondo. I call it the front stance, or the Ahp Sogi. That's what I learned it as at my home studio of Royal West Martial Arts. You'll hear in ITF Taekwondo, it's going to be called the walking stance, or the Gunan Sogi, or Gunan Sogi. I don't know how to pronounce Korean, so you can go ahead and correct my pronunciation in the comments if you know better than I do. I don't call it the walking stance because there's a different stance that I call the walking stance that maybe we'll cover in a different video. So let's see how it is done according to traditional Taekwondo. Let's take a look. All right, so that's me. Now, before anybody asks, yes, that is a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu gi. No, I'm not a black belt in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. I'm a white belt in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. I don't even have my first stripe in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. The reason I'm wearing a Jiu-Jitsu gi is simply because they are just an objectively better gi, and they're all I train in. But I don't want to give you the impression that I'm a black belt. That goal is years away. Now, the stance I'm in is a natural parallel stance. You'll notice that my feet are exactly shoulder width. I'm going to keep it that way throughout this entire exercise. A front stance is also going to be shoulder width, so I'm going to take my left foot and drive it forward 1.5 shoulder widths. In other words, the length of the stance is going to be 1.5 times its width. Sometimes you'll see people step deeper and go 2 shoulder widths. Sometimes you'll see them step a lot wider. Both of these are incorrect according to the Encyclopedia of Taekwondo, which is what we follow. Now you'll notice that the front knee is bent. You may hear people say that you should bend your knee far enough that you can't see your front toe. That'll actually be slightly too far. You'll see if I do that, I create a slight incline on my shin. You should be able to draw an imaginary vertical line from your kneecap to your heel. So, from your perspective, you should still be able to slightly see your front toe. But, if you can see your knee, your shin, your ankle, your instep, and all 5 toes, your knee isn't bent far enough. My feet are almost parallel. They're not quite parallel. If your stance is shoulder width, you won't be able to make your feet perfectly parallel, and you're not supposed to. Your back foot should be rotated out 25 degrees, making it comfortable on your knee. Make sure to lock your back leg and keep your back heel on the ground. My shoulders and hips are square, facing forward. I said the length of the stance is 1.5 times the width. What that means is that if we draw invisible corners, we have a rectangle. It's not a square. It's a rectangle. If the stance were perfectly square, we'd be able to pivot our feet and we'd be facing a new direction in the same stance. But we can't do that because of the rectangular shape of the stance. If we try rotating in a rectangular stance, you'll see that now we have a problem, because the width is 1.5 times the length, which is incorrect. So to get around this issue, when we pivot, the front foot slides back slightly, and after we make the turn, it slides back again. The back leg simply pivots, but the front foot needs to move in order to maintain the correct stance after the transition is complete. This is going to be really important because basically the entire form of Saju Chidigi Saju Maki is based on this concept. Okay, let's talk about another transition. This is just a simple step. We can use it to pivot 90 degrees, or 180 degrees, or simply step forwards and backwards. When we do, our feet may come slightly together as we shift our weight between steps. In old-style karate, you'll see this big C step, or in some forms of Taekwondo, they'll bring their feet together and then back out to shoulder width. That kind of movement is not needed. Just move your foot forward in a straight line, and again, it may come in slightly just due to the way that your weight is distributed, but don't C-step. One more transition. This will be our Dwiro Dora, or about face. If I'm in a left front stance, I'm going to bring my left foot in about 6 inches and slightly back. Then I'm going to turn 180 degrees to face my body in the opposite direction, and then adjust my new front foot into a right front stance. Okay? Here it is coming back. If you ever hear that command, Wirotora, that means about face, and this is how we do it. This is really going to be important when we get to the form Dosan, and several times after that. Alright, so let's talk a little bit about the purpose of the front stance. Here we have a fight that I filmed where I actually attempted to use the front stance as a primary fighting stance, and as you can see, it's not working super well. I never recommend that you do this. In order to kick, I have to shift my weight, which is time-consuming and clunky. I can land a jab, like that one, and my kicks are hard, and meanwhile, I'm open to just about anything my opponent wants to throw at me. Not a very good option to use as a primary fighting strategy. Now this holds true in other styles as well. This is a Kyokushin karate fight, and these fighters are facing forward a lot more than I typically do in a Taekwondo fight, but even here you're not seeing a deep front stance like we were seeing earlier. This is a lot more mobile. This is almost more similar to a boxer's stance. But that's not to say that there are no real-world applications for a front stance. This is a Muay Thai fight. In a second, one of these guys is going to be knocked out, and I want you to watch how it happens. Boom! Devastating knee to the face. Now watch how he sets it up. He goes into the clinch, and boom! You see it right there? Perfect front stance to set up the knee. You'll see that again and again in Muay Thai and mixed martial arts. Also, from a self-defense perspective, okay, this is a technique to use against what I call the bully grab, okay, when someone's got you by the lapels and trying to shove you up against a locker. You kind of don't want to be there. So you can use a front stance to establish your base and set up an escape, followed up by a knockout punch. Let's see it again. This has been Mr. T with another episode of the Bunkai Breakdown, reminding you that perfection is our goal, but excellence will be tolerated.